What is going on, everybody? Jumbo Thick here, and we are going to start our second Q&A video. As a quick heads up on what's happening with the channel so far, I have been slightly absent the past couple days because of an event that just happened in my life. Let's just put it like this. I just had a baby. Of course, you know, if I had a baby myself, I'd be super rich, but my wife just had a baby, and it is mine. It's my baby, and we just had a baby girl, and it was supposed to be quick and easy and over and done, but sadly, most things work out these days, it got slightly complicated, and she had to end up getting a C-section after being in labor for quite some time. And now my baby has jaundice, and so on and so forth. You guys probably don't care that much, but just so you know, that's why I've been slightly absent, and we'll probably miss maybe one or two episodes in the next week or so, but I'm really trying to get back on schedule and get everything back up and running, just like usual. So I do want to kick off our Q&A video. So I posted a video a few days back and asked you guys if you guys had any questions in commemoration of our 1,000 subscriber mark, which now we are a little over 1,100 now. So just in about a week or so, we have gained another 100 followers, and that is just so awesome. And I just really wanted to say thank you guys and then answer some questions that I've gotten in the past and share with everybody, because not a lot of people will actually read comments. I know I didn't when I was first watching YouTube before I really got into it. And so it's just a good way to get everybody to hear, you know, more detailed lore questions or really anything. So let's go ahead and get this started now. So my first question comes from Gay Tony. Well, that's with two Y's. So Gay E Tony. Am I gay or straight? Well, I think I just answered that question. So let's move on to the next one. The next one comes from, I'm probably going to say this wrong, Petrucci Ibiza? Libiza? And basically says, what new units from the Skaven roster DLC from Clannishan would I expect to see in the either DLC expansions or maybe possibly even in the next Total War? Warhammer 3, which is what it'll be. Now, we actually got an extra Clannishan unit this time around. It was old lore. The assassins that we got, the Death Runners, they do exist in lore, but in tabletop, the models were from an older version. They weren't the current 8th edition army book. And so it was interesting that CA went back and got those. But other than that, on tabletop, the only Clannishan units are Night Runners, Gutter Runners, and then Assassins. Now, we did get the Death Runners, plus we do have the Assassins. So technically, we've gotten all of the fabricated tabletop models for Clannishan. Now, in the lore fluff, if they really wanted to flesh out Clannishan as its own, you know, its own faction, which it does exist in the game. So all of the major factions for the Skaven roster are actually in Total War Warhammer 2. You got Clan Scryer, Clan Eshin, you have Clan Mulder, then you have Clan... Well, you know what? I don't know if we have Clan Mulder. I haven't seen it. I think we have Clan Mulder, but then we have Clan Pestilence, obviously. And to flesh out, those are the big four, and then, of course, Clan Morse, which we do have, which is almost in the big four. And now we even have Clan Rictus, which is close to Clan Moors in popularity, but not quite there. So that gets a little more complicated. I do plan on doing a lore video on Clan Rictus and Tretch Craventel eventually, hopefully soon. So anyways, to answer your question, I don't see them adding many more units, but if they wanted to really reach back into the lore fluff, there are some very interesting dynamics that could bring to Clannishan. For instance, Clannishan actually have their own sorcerers. It's very low-key, it's very secretive, and they have their own take on all of the classical Skaven units, even some of the Clan Mulder units. But the interesting part is they have their own sorcerers, and it's more akin to a fire magic. You see this in one of the Thankful novels, where he ends up stuck with some clandestine units to go kill a famous lizardman deity, as they say, the prophet of Sotek. They sent him to go murder the prophet of Sotek. It gets complicated. I don't want to ruin it for you guys, but you get to see this Skaven sorcerer that uses a different lore of magic, which is very unique. And if they wanted to add that as a little nod to the fluff, I could see that being done. Now, do I expect it? No, I don't expect it. In addition to that, the clanesian units as well, whenever you read from that book, you can see that they have rat ogres that they've trained in stealth, so they're very, very good at sneaking despite their massive size, but still loyal to a fault. And you know, they still have the same typical Skaven issues. But Clan Eshin does have their own clan rats, just like all the other Skaven clans, and so on and so forth. Their own slaves, and it's not just assassins, but they do specialize in those types of units. So it would be interesting if they flushed it out. Now, as I said earlier, though, I really don't expect them to do that. It would be awesome if they did, but I wouldn't get my hopes up. And now on to the next question. I hope I answered your question. The next one comes from Christian Butler, and it says, do you think that in the third Total War Warhammer game, they will go all the way to Cathay, or do you think they would stay only in the Darklands with the Ogre Kingdoms and the Chaos Doors, because Cathay barely has any lore and doesn't even have any tabletop units? So I have talked about this a lot with a few other of my colleagues, I'd call them, and friends, and I really would love to see Cathay and Nippon actually fleshed out. CA could do it. I feel like they have the ability to, because they've done so much with Norska, because Norska didn't really have its own official roster, and they kind of piecemealed it from all of the old stuff and brought in the lore. They were very true to the lore and kind of read between the lines and kind of fleshed out what Norska should be. And I feel like if they could do that exact same thing with Ind, Nippon, or Cathay. Cathay would be the biggest, honestly, because it has the most connections within the Warhammer world. It gets talked about quite a bit. There's lots of trade routes, and they have a relationship with the Tomb Kings and a few other factions. And it's just, oh man, it would be so awesome. I would love to see it. Those little Chinese, Japanese, Indian influences into the, you know, grim, dark Warhammer fantasy universe. It would be so fantastic to see flushed out, and I would trust CA to do it. Now, will they actually do it? I don't think they will. As much as I want it to happen, I just don't think that they're going to expand the map that much more. I think that the third game is going to be as much as what most people have expected. The only mortal races we're going to be getting are what you actually closed in on. It are the Chaos Dwarves and the Ogre Kingdoms. I don't foresee us getting anything else, really. That's all that there really is in the Darklands that we don't already have. There are, of course, like the marauding tribes like the Hmong and the Hung, and the various different greenskin tribes that occupy that area. But other than that, those are the only unique races. What I think the third game is going to be the individual Chaos Gods. It'll be the Demons of Chaos, which I will eventually do a video on as well. Sometimes in the near future, I hope. But I think we'll be getting a dedicated Khorne, Nurgle, Slaanesh, and Tzeentch army for each one, which they have their own individual armies. Well, they kind of do. They do. You could build an army of just a specific deity and you get buffs and things like that. But you could also have a mixed army. So I'd be interested to see how they're going to do this. I'm hoping they go with the individual gods and that they have specific units. Like, you can't have Khorne units in a Slaaneshi army. You know what I mean? So I really hope that they do it that way, and it's not just a blank, ooh, here's the Demons of Chaos faction, and here's all the demons you get. I would prefer if they split it into four and have each legendary lord have a separate army. Or, I mean, it could just be a faction. It could just be four different factions and then fill in lords from there. Because all the demons of chaos, the actual demon lords, legendary heroes or lords, whatever you'd like to call them, do exist, with the exception of Slaanesh. Slaanesh doesn't have any lords, they just have heroes. But I mean, they've already done this in the past. CA has taken a hero character with almost no lore. I'm looking at you, Helmengorst, and flushing them out and giving them their own starting position as a legendary lord. So I see that happening, and I hope that's how it goes. Now, I would love if they added the Far East. It would be so awesome. But I don't have, I also, much like the other Clan Eshin units that I kind of talked about, I don't have high hopes. And I don't want to get your hopes up either. It would be awesome, and I foresee probably maybe some modders, if there are some really dedicated modders in the community. I could see them maybe adding them, but that's going to be the only way I think we're going to see it. I don't think CA is going to actually put the effort into flushing them out, unless, and here's going to be the only way I will just kind of change my stance on this. We have the opportunity for CA to flesh out Albion as its own faction. It's in Warhammer 2. You can go to the island of Albion. It exists. You can see it in the Mortal Empires campaign. You can get to it in the Vortex campaign. It's slightly above Ulthuan. It's between Ulthuan and the kind of the Chaos Wastes, where Norskov would be. Not really the Chaos Wastes, the Norskan territories, I guess you'd call it. And they have their own faction. It's very unique. It would be really easy for them to implement if they really wanted to. It's very similar to Norska, just with a kind of a different take, a very, how would I call this? A very European, UK kind of medieval, not really medieval, like, you know what I mean, you know what I'm talking about, right? Like a tribal kind of feel, I guess I'd call it. Like the British tribes kinds of things. So all you European people will probably be like, oh, I know what you're talking about. and you're screwing it up, blundering around, but that's okay. That's not what you guys tune in for. You just tune in for to hear me ramble occasionally, I hope at least. So let's move on to the next question. I think we answered then that one as much as I can, at least. All right, and my next comment, or question, I should say, also comes from Patrucci Ibiza. So it says, how come I know so much about the Warhammer universe? And this, I like this question, because I don't have a traditional knowledge of the Warhammer universe, and meaning that if you've seen my past Q&A, you know that I actually never played tabletop. I was drawn to Warhammer because of the fantasy books, the Warhammer novels. They are extremely well written, if you haven't read any of the novels. And in the future, I'd like to do like a dedicated, like, hey, these are good novels to start with. But if you guys have questions, you can leave that in the comment section. I don't want to get into it too much in this video, because it's kind of its own topic. But I really like the lore. It's a very rich and unique universe. And you could tell that Creative Assembly put a lot of love into this in the beginning. They put a lot of love into crafting a believable and unique fantasy setting. And it's just, it's such a great setting, and that's why I got very interested into it. Now, that's what drew me in originally, was the lore behind this. And the reason why that happened is because Total War Warhammer, the original, was announced, and I knew nothing about it. I was like, oh, it looks kind of cool. One of my friends said, hey, that's an old game, and I kind of did some research into it, and I'm pretty much completely self-taught, and I've been compiling books, I've been ordering books like you wouldn't believe. I have to have the written word. I don't like reading off a screen, so I import all my books, mostly from the UK, because since I live in America, it's hard. It's hard to get a hold of books. Locally, that is. I end up having to order a lot of my books online and have them imported from the UK, where it's very easy for you guys to get a hold of Warhammer Fantasy stuff, especially since it's died out now that they've kind of replaced it with Age of Sigmar. Everything's really expensive, even for low quality stuff. So I do my best to, I do a lot of reading and a lot of research, and that's kind of how I know as much as I do. Now, I also have read the majority of the army books. Now, I won't say I'm an expert on all the army books. I do get things wrong occasionally, but I have read most of the army books, and I do go out of my way to, whenever I'm covering a new topic, For instance, back when I was covering the Dark Elves, I know quite a bit about the Dark Elves from the fantasy novels, but I want to make sure that lines up, because sometimes it doesn't, with the actual lore written in the army books. And so I will get a hold of a PDF for these army books, because I am not shelling out hundreds of dollars for an old army book that nobody uses anymore. And, you know, it gets out of control. I will say that Games Workshop does, they really value their written word, I would say. It's expensive. It's very, all of it is expensive. Not just the army books, but even the regular novels are much more expensive than they would be for an average book. So, oof. Anyways, I'm kind of drifting off topic again. So, I will get a hold of those PDFs and I will kind of compare them with the knowledge I have, and then I kind of choose what I think best fits. There's a lot of things that don't mesh. A lot of times where maybe an author has taken more liberties, but I think that that makes an interesting, more interesting topic, and so I'll kind of go with that, and that's kind of how I reason it in my head. So that's how I do my thing. That's how I know as much as I do. So if you wanted to know as much as me, you could do the exact same thing. Go ahead and start ordering books. I hope you have the money to afford them. Or you could always just go to the Black Library online site and you can just pay a monthly subscription. I think they could do monthly subscriptions, I'm pretty sure, last time I checked. Anyways, you can get it all digital. And that would be a much faster and easier way. But I don't know, I'm just old school. I have to have the paper in front of me. All right, so our next topic comes from Zarguz Hedwaka. It's an interesting name. Almost as interesting as Jumbo Thick, I must say. So I will probably pronounce some of your guys' names wrong. I apologize in advance. I'm not the pronunciation guy. I barely can speak English as it is, and that's my first language. So forgive me if I mispronounce your name. But Zarguz asks, if Skaven are so craven and cowardly creatures, why are so many of them willing to join armies? So, and he also says I should cover demons soon, and I will eventually. I want to hit all the races, all in due time, good sir, all in due time. But I kind of covered this a little bit in my Skaven videos. So, essentially, the Skaven are very interesting when it comes to fighting, because they are very cowardly creatures in general, with the exception of certain individuals such as Queek Headtaker. He is a freak amongst the Skaven, and I've covered him in detail. So if you really want to learn more about Queek, I have a Queek Headtaker video you should check out, and you will learn everything you want to know about Queek, or at least everything I think is important to know about Queek. But there are people like, there are ratmen, I shouldn't say people, should I? There are ratmen like Queek, and a lot of the Eshin assassin units, the actual assassins themselves, are very brave creatures in general, and that might not be, it might be deceptive. Like, I think it's more of a, it's that fight or flight mechanic, but it's like they've trained their body to go into fight mode instead of flight mode, even though they're terrified. So, and it makes them fight harder for that reason. Kind of the way that they talk about, if you corner an animal, it'll fight twice as hard and more viciously. Same principle applies to Skaven. They are beyond cowardly. They value themselves above all others, especially those of their own kind. And the reason that they can get them to even form any kind of fighting force is the Skaven, especially when they're born, they have a natural affinity of being around other Skaven. And so I want to believe this is called, in the tabletop, I think it's called Verminous Valor? I don't quote me on exactly what the rule is, but there's a tabletop rule that essentially what it is the more Skaven you have in a unit, like the higher the morale is occasionally. So they feel comforted by having more Skaven around them. And that's mostly in their mind as, oh, well, that guy's going to get stabbed before I do, essentially, is what's the way it works out. And they see overwhelming numbers as being, oh, yeah, we got this. That's the only reason why they will ever attack. If they think that there's even a chance that it's going to be a fair fight, that they don't have the advantage, they will not fight at all. It doesn't matter how big of an army they have. If they think that there is at a disadvantage, they're not going to do commit willingly. They won't willingly commit. And you see this often. For instance, Thankful, the infamous Grayseer Thankwell. He plans a lot of ambushes and attacks on various peoples, mostly the Empire and whatnot, but there is a famous kind of ambush that he sets up in one of the Gotrek and Felix novels, where he ambushes a Kislevite stronghold, and he's so proud of himself because he rallies a bunch of basically gets a large garrison from Clan Mulder to come help him take this kind of far out distant castle that borders the Chaos Waste in preparation of a dwarven airship being taken. He wants to capture the airship and basically use it as a bargaining chip to rule Skavendom, as all Skaven plans. All Skaven plans are very selfish and one-sided. They all involve themselves being great and everyone else worshiping them. But we're straying off topic here. He talks about how, after the fact, they hit the manor in the middle of the night, of course, in complete surprise. And he is completely proud of himself that they managed to capture the manor with very few losses on the humans. They mostly capture most of them. And he is so proud of himself that he says, "Oh man, we captured this and we only outnumbered them 10 to 1. And we still captured it." And he's so proud of himself that they only outnumbered the Kislevites 10 to 1. And they still managed to pull it off. And that just goes to show you how cowardly and pathetic these beings are. Because in his mind, he thinks 10 to 1 are bad odds. In his mind, he's like, "Oh man, they might still win." And that just goes to show you how terrible Skaven morale is and how crappy their average troops are. Even the Storm Vermin are cowardly when not in numbers. An individual Storm Vermin is not going to fight on the way a lowly foot soldier would, in like a Bretonian, even a Bretonian peasant would fight longer than a damn Skaven, you know, just general infantryman in a one-on-one fight, unless they thought they had the upper hand once again. But that's kind of the only way that they kind of get them to form into ranks and kind of hold them at bay, is one, through sheer terror, because they're terrified of the boss, who always stands very distantly from the fighting for the most part and points a large sharp object at anyone trying to run and stabs them to assert their dominance as is. So they have to make them so scared to turn to flee that they have to push forward, is the only other way that they kind of drive everyone forward. But for the most part, it comes from that strength in numbers, that they just feel safe. They feel like they got this with all their treacherous rat men around them, even though they all hate each other. And my next question comes from Hank Trim, which he commented a little while ago, and I thought I replied, but I thought I'd share it with all of you guys anyway, since I have been covering the Tomb Kings lately, if you do not know. So he asked if Arkhan the Black was my favorite Tomb King. And I've kind of said this in my Arkhan campaign, if you've listened to it a little bit, which I am still going to finish. I'm not leaving it high and dry. I plan on juggling Kingdom Come and Warhammer 2 for a little while, until one or the other's finished. And of course, when the new expansion comes out for Warhammer 2, I'll be covering that as well. So anyways, he basically asked if Arkhan the Black was my favorite Tomb King. And yes, he is by far my favorite Tomb King. And I feel like it's almost unfair that he's grouped in with the Tomb Kings. It's the way that CA, or I should say Games Workshop, justified, kind of. They never really made a model for him until the end times, but they kind of put him in to kind of give a nod to Nagash, like, hey, you can play as a Nagash, kind of like a mini Nagash essentially, and Arkhan the Black. And there's this lots of deep lore behind him. He has a very active role in both the Tomb King and the Vampire Counts lore, like their background and their history. He shows up in a ton of fantasy books. And he's a very interesting and deep character. When you look at the fantasy books, when you're looking at just the lore coming from the army books, he seems rather bland and kind of extremely subservient, which is kind of the route they kind of took with Warhammer 2 when you hear his dialogue, which I'm not a big fan of, honestly. I've always seen him as the Arkin that I've seen in the Warhammer fantasy novels. He was essentially a very gullible and kind of downtrodden lesser noble that was taken advantage of by Nagash before he became what he is now. And kind of essentially through hundreds and thousands of years has just beat down Arkin and essentially enslaved him to his will. He has to obey Nagash. Nagash has bound him to his will. Now, he fights it. He fights it often, but he knows that his place is by his master's side, and he's almost kind of begrudgingly accepted it, but that doesn't mean he has to like it. You know, that's kind of how that's the way I interpret him, at least. I feel like that's a more interesting way to look at Arkin. And that's kind of the cool thing about a lot of Warhammer lore in general, is it's in the eye of the beholder, essentially. The fantasy novels did a really good job of fleshing out these characters that somewhat seemed a little dull, if we're being honest here. They seemed rather dull on the pages. Some of them don't. For instance, like Setra, when you read Setra's background, I did a whole lore video on Setra, and all of that lore was taken from the army books. And it is very interesting, and you can kind of see how his life developed, and he's one of those unique characters that they seem to craft a lot of story into, whereas with Arkin, there's not as much. There's only a couple pages, and he's such an important character that you would think, man, why haven't you guys dedicated some time to this guy? And that's what the fantasy novels were for. He has a very big role in the Nagash series, the Age of Legends. Wait, is that what it's called? Something of Legends? Time of Legends, not Age of Legends. I'm thinking of Age of Sigmar. The Time of Legends series on Nagash is very good, very long, but very good. And Arkin has a very prevalent part in that, as well as in a few of the Vampire Count history kind of Time of Legends novels as well. So, but he's definitely my favorite character. I kind of just relate, and well, not relate. I'm not a dead walking black skeleton, but you know, maybe inside I am. So I just find him a very interesting character, and yeah, he's definitely my favorite Tomb King, even though in my opinion I think there should be a Nagash faction with his followers, because Arkin would be in there, and there's a couple others that would be under his umbrella that I think should be separated from the Tomb Kings, and then there's a few from the Vampire Count roster that I think should also serve under Nagash's umbrella. And that is going to be it for today's Q&A, guys. If you have questions or comments or concerns, go ahead and leave them down in the comment section, guys. As usual, I've pulled all these comments from my previous videos. There are some I missed. Now, I do try to do my best to reply to comments in the comment section that you wrote your comment in. So if you're interested in if I have answered one of your questions, go ahead and check back on that video and you should see a reply. I do my best to hit them all. Sometimes I forget. I mean, I get a lot of comments, not a ton, but enough to the point where it's hard for me to keep up with all of them at once. So unfortunately, YouTube is not my full-time job. I wish it was, and I wish it could be. And God willing, if this channel keeps growing and you guys just keep giving me all the support and the views and everything that you guys have been doing as you have, then God willing, one day I will be able to make this my full-time job. And that would really be a dream of mine, to do this full-time. So as usual, guys, just thank you so much. Thank you guys for all the support. And just being very, very patient with me, because you guys have all, we've have a very patient and very understanding community here on the Jumbo Thick channel. And I'm just very appreciative of you guys for that reason, because I've seen so many other toxic YouTuber channels where it's not just the guy speaking, it's just the community he has is very negative. And of course he kind of also might stoke the fire a little bit, but there's one guy in particular, I'm not gonna name names, but there's a few communities out there that are very negative, and I like the fact that we have such a very positive and accepting community, and it makes me excited. It makes me excited to make videos for you guys and to share my knowledge and to, you know, help people discover new things, essentially, that's kind of my goal. That's what I want to do with YouTube. So as usual, guys, I appreciate it. I have been Jumbo Thick. Thank you oh so much for watching. I look forward to seeing you guys all very soon. Have a good day.